Struck. Hey, thanks for tuning in for another edition of Drunk with Nintendo Power. Last time we looked at Volume 25 featuring Battletoads on the cover, so today let's take a look at the very next issue, Volume 26, featuring Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves for NES on the cover. Again, I sincerely apologize for the amateur quality of this video. I'm not exactly an expert on filming stuff, but enough of you liked the last video well enough, so I thought I'd try another one. So let's start by looking at the stuff featured in every Nintendo Power issue, starting with the mailbag. Here we see the infamous Game Boy that was burned up in a fire during Operation Desert Storm. Its owner actually mailed it back to Nintendo asking for a replacement, and believe it or not, the thing actually still turned on when hooked up with a battery pack, and the start and select buttons still worked. That's pretty damn amazing. Next, there's the Nestor's Adventures comic, which features Nestor attending a summer camp telling scary stories around a campfire. Sure, okay. This month's classified information has a stage select code for Little Nemo the Dream Master, as well as the Lone Ranger, and there's an amusing section on Dragon Warrior 2. There's no codes here, it simply tells you what to do at the end of the game, since evidently the game itself did a poor job of telling the player that. There's a ton of passwords and an unlockable sound test for Low G Man. I remember being interested in this game only because it was in classified information like 3 or 4 times. And there's a tip to summon your tag team partner to interfere in the middle of a match in WWF Wrestling Challenge. This month's poster is a great shot of Samus advertising the forthcoming Metroid 2 for Game Boy. The other side of the poster I'll get to a bit later. The Now Playing section features High Speed, a video pinball game for NES, Legends of the Diamond, a decent baseball game featuring old-time Hall of Fame players, a shoot-'em-up called Over Horizon, and Videomation, kind of a precursor to Mario Paint but for NES. So really nothing all that interesting. For this month's contest, you win a Super Nintendo. Well, damn, I'll take that. You also win a trip to beautiful Redmond, Washington to tour Nintendo of America's headquarters. Second place is a Game Boy, third place is you're fired. Sorry, I couldn't resist the Glengarry Glen Ross joke there. The Counselor's Corner features a lot of questions about deja vu, including what you need to clear your name from being a murder suspect, as well as how to rig the money-making game in Legend of Zelda, where you use the second controller to save in the middle of the game. There's also solutions to tricky puzzles in the game Puznik, and some handy answers to questions like what the hell do I do and where the hell do I go for the game Faria. Here's a shot of this month's counselors, including this dude who says he beat Legend of Zelda without a sword. I remember reading that as a kid and thinking that guy had to be joking, but yeah, as you probably know, that's a legitimate thing that can be done. Hearing about it back then, though, seemed crazy. Super Mario Bros. 3 reclaims the top spot in the top 30, taking it back from Turtles 2, the arcade game. Like I said last time, it's cool to see which games show up on the fringes of this list, like Battle of Olympus. The celebrity profile is Marcia Warfield, also known as Roz from Night Court, where she complains about how hard Mario 3 is, especially World 8. The NES Achieve section has all the high scores mailed in for the month, including one dude who finished Advanced Dungeons & Dragons Heroes of the Lands, and one dude who finished Bandit Kings of Ancient China. PackWatch takes a look at future NES games, which this month has Defenders of Dinatron City, Star Trek, Ninja Gaiden 3, Treasure Master, Wolverine, among others. Okay, let's get to the main features, the big one being for Robin Hood Prince of Thieves for NES, which gets 16 pages of maps and all sorts of hints. They scored this game 4.3 out of 5, which is pretty good, and pretty odd since you never ever hear about this game today, but I guess they liked it at the time. The big selling point they harp on here is that the story follows the movie scene for scene. Well, whoop-de-doo. There's also an 8-page feature on Rockin' Cats, a game based on the Saturday morning cartoon. It's cool to see them put in so much detail, even in games like this, that might not get a lot of attention otherwise. There's 4 pages on Capcom's The Little Mermaid, a game I looked at a long time ago, which is a short but well-made game. There's Bill and Ted's Excellent Video Game Adventure, a game that was later honored by an Angry Video Game Nerd episode. Nintendo Power gives the controls here 2.2 out of 5, which is as low as I've ever seen them give a game. The monthly Game Boy feature has Who Framed Roger Rabbit, the InfoGenius Productivity Pack, Sneaky Snakes, Navy SEALs, Dick Tracy, Altered Space, which is a really interesting looking 3D puzzle game featuring 8 long levels where you go from room to room avoiding enemies and discovering new areas. Blades of Steel is here as well, and there's also codes for games like Mercenary Force, Lock and Chase, and Burai Fighter Deluxe. Last but not least, we have yet another preview of the Super Nintendo, which was mere months away from release in North America. Right away, they make it a point to say that the Super Nintendo won't just be an NES with better graphics, since it features effects like Mode 7, shown here with F-Zero, and it claims that foreground objects are redrawn as many as 60 times per second? What? It shows off the effect of Mario flipping behind a fence. I always thought that was really cool at the time. It talks about scaling and again showing off pilot wings, and it talks about the huge sprite certain games will have, as big as 128 by 128 pixels, like the first level boss of Gradius 3 here. They talk about color layering, and a game called Demolition is discussed, not to be confused with Demolition Man, of course. But does anyone know what game this ended up being by any chance? Because there isn't a game called Demolition on Super Nintendo. Anyway, there's talk of multiple scrolling backgrounds while showing off super ghouls and ghosts, and again the sound is highlighted, saying, "When the soundtrack is combined with the clarity and colors of the graphics, the effect is so stunning that it's like you're controlling an interactive movie." Well, I don't know about that, but okay. After that, we get a huge layout of screenshots for 29 different games that will eventually be released for Super Nintendo in North America. There's Mario World, F-Zero, Link to the Past, titled Zelda 3 here, Pilot Wings, Super Play Action Football, Gradius 3, Super Bases Loaded, Super R-Type, Augusta Golf, which was later renamed YLA Country Club, Darius Twin, listed as Darius here, Final Fight, Draken, without the H in the title, SimCity, ActRaiser, Super Ghouls and Ghosts, Legend of the Mystical Ninja, Jumbo Ozaki's Hole-in-One, later renamed Hal's Hole-in-One Golf, Super Castlevania 4, just called Castlevania 4 here, Populous, UN Squadron, Baseball Simulator 1000, which is listed under its Japanese title here of Super Ultra Baseball, Battle Dodgeball, which never left Japan, a game called Gadoolin, an RPG titled GD Lean in Japan that never ended up being translated, and then there's games like the first SD Great Battle game, and Big Run, both of which never left Japan. And there's Ultraman, D-Force, Bomboozle, which was released in North America as Kablooey, and finally Final Fantasy II, which is of course Final Fantasy IV. Whew! Alright, that's enough for now. Thanks for watching, and have a good rest of your day.